How's everybody feeling? Surprise, I was going to ask you a question. Here we go, let's try it again. How's everybody feeling? Good. All right. Even if you just woke up, I appreciate you faking it for a little bit. Hey, I'm excited about this morning. I'm excited about where we're going today. My name's Harrison. I'm one of the pastors on the team out in Statesboro. So we're pretty excited about that. Hey, thank you. Yes, Statesboro's awesome. But hey, listen, I don't know if you know this, but there have been a lot of really amazing things happening in our church. So if you're new, let me just share some of the amazing things that are going on. And it's okay when you hear something to get a little excited, all right? And so there we go. That's the open door to be a little bit like, hey, you know, yeah, all right, there we go. So for those who don't know, this last year, listen to this, the Effingham campus has moved into their student building. Yeah, that's exciting. The worship center here at Henderson has come online. That's exciting. Yeah, give it up. Yep, cool. The East Campus has recently opened more space, children and students. That's amazing stuff. Yep. The Midway Campus has launched a few weeks ago. That's amazing. And man, listen to this. Statesboro Campus is moving in less than a month. Hey, listen, people in Statesboro are going crazy right now because we are just stoked, man. It's amazing to see God doing all kinds of amazing things. And listen, it's amazing to see God do awesome things through a few crazy people willing to step up, right? A few crazy people willing to set their eyes on eternal things. Set their eyes on things that matter, things a little bit beyond the here and the now. You see, your sacrifice in the One campaign has made so many amazing things happen, and they continue to happen, and it's all because God has said, I want to use some crazy people. Who is willing to step up? And we said, pick us. You know, I mean, put me on a team, coach, you know. And he's doing all kind of amazing things right now. But I love how Pastor Cam continues to drive this thought home. Listen, the most exciting thing is not the buildings. The most exciting thing right now is not the buildings. The most exciting thing is the capacity these buildings now provide for people's lives to change. Heads up, these buildings aren't going to show up at your workplace. These buildings aren't going to show up at your campus. These buildings aren't going to start leading your family. You need to do those things. But here's what's awesome. These buildings now give us a new capacity and ability to share the story of Jesus and how he changes everything. It's an amazing time for us. It's an amazing opportunity to be a part of this. And here's what I hope. I'm going to pray here in a minute, but I hope that we're going to buy in. Let's be all in right now. Let's see what God has for us, and let's leave here changed. You ready? Let's pray. Here we go. Father, we're thankful for your grace. You didn't have to invite us into this, but you did. You didn't have to allow us to see how you're changing lives all around us, but you did. You opened up that door for us. Your grace has covered us. Even if we're far from you, your grace has saved us on a number of occasions if we would only turn our eyes to you. We've seen you at work in our lives. We've seen you doing amazing things. And it is by your grace that we get to experience that and enjoy that. And so help us now. Your word's going to change something this morning, and we're glad that it is. But give us the ears to hear, the eyes to see what you are about, and let us leave here changed. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hey, listen, we're in this series called Power, right? We're talking about the power of the Holy Spirit. For those who are in Christ, the promise is that you would receive the gift of the Spirit. And we talk about Jesus all the time. We know who Jesus is. We talk about all that he's done. What we don't talk about a lot is the power of the Spirit. And we need to be a people devoted to and living by the power of the Spirit. So we're going to wrap this series up today. And let me just kind of jump in and share a quick story with you to help us understand where we're going. All right, so in high school, I was playing football, and I love playing football. I had these amazing coaches that still, I think back on the impact they've had in my life, and I just love it. I mean, if you're a coach, you're coaching young men, you're coaching young women, listen, you have an opportunity to change their lives by investing in them, so I hope that you will. But I had one coach who was slightly crazy, and he liked being creative. Anybody have creative coaches? You know, they came up with creative ways to practice things. They came up with creative drills, and they came up with creative consequences. Anybody have that, coach? So here's what happened. We had I'll tell you one consequence that I got to enjoy from my coach. One summer, I was a junior, we came in, and we found this golf cart. And on the back of this golf cart was this T-bar that had been welded to the back of this dead golf cart. And here's the deal. If you missed a practice, there were consequences. You missed a workout, there were consequences. You messed up royally in the game, there are consequences. And so what he decided to, instead of running after games or running laps or pulling tires or something, he's like, you know what? Why don't we push this dead golf cart around the track a few times? And in my family, no kidding, so he welded this T-bar, and that was our consequence. All right, go push the golf cart around the track. I'm like, are you serious? He's like, yeah. And so what happened is, in my family, God was first. I'm amazingly blessed by this. God was first. Family was next. Football fell somewhere down here. And so what that meant for the summer is we would go to summer camps. We would go on family vacations and spend time. And I had racked up from missed workouts miles of pushing this golf cart around a stinking track. You know what I mean? And so what would happen after practice is like, all right, dude, you got to get in at least 3 laps today because you got to start cutting back on these things. And so hopefully someone else got in trouble and you got to push it with a buddy. That was the thing you were praying for, that someone else really screwed up, which is a bad thing to pray for, but it happens. We all do it. I mean, we all do it. So after a while, after a few miles of pushing this dead golf cart around a track, I realized I don't want my buddy driving the golf cart anymore. My buddies were usually juniors or linemen or just big people, and I don't want big people driving my golf cart. I went for the freshman wide receivers, you know, like the D-backs that I'm like, that barely weigh 100 pounds. And I'm like, you drive this car, and if your foot touches that brake pedal, it is game over for you. I needed someone that feared me a little bit because I'm not like an intimidating person. So I'm like, give me the smallest freshman you got, you know. And so, but here's the deal. That's when I realized, and I really began to appreciate the difference between depending on an existing power source. Because before this time, I never really appreciated the golf cart engine. I thought it was kind of lame, to be honest. I mean, it's slow. There's no, like, thrill to it. And so I thought the golf cart engine was lame. But after this experience, I became glad to depend on the existing power source instead of being forced to become the power source for that golf cart. Let me just give you a heads up. What's worse than a slow golf cart is having to become the engine for a dead golf cart. All right, that ride is not that exciting. A mile of pushing a golf cart is just not that exciting. So let's just do this real fast. Would you rather quiz? You guys know this, right? Would you rather, whatever. So would you rather go skiing off the back of a motorboat or a kayak? Anybody? Anybody even tried skiing off a kayak? Okay, if you send me a YouTube video of a squirrel skiing off the back of the kayak, you win 100 points. Okay, would you rather, don't do it right now though. I know some of you, I'm funny right now. Would you rather drive to Atlanta or ride your bicycle? Some of you are like, I can ride a bicycle to Atlanta. I'm like, good for you. Okay, would you rather ride an escalator or take the stairs? 100 times in a row. Ah, come on. 100 times in a row. Okay, listen. So we can all kind of be on the same page about this, right? We can all agree that depending on a greater power source is often better than being forced to become the power source, because honestly, it seems a little silly to try skiing off the back of a kayak because it's not going to work. You know what I mean? It might be funny for about 30 seconds, but then it just gets old, all right? But yet, here's the reality for us, okay? Listen, here's the reality for when it comes to matters of spirituality, matters of faith, we do this stuff all the time. In certain things, it makes sense. Like, of course, I'm going to depend on the existing power source because it's better. It just makes sense. But for some reason, when it comes to spirituality and faith, we think the other all the time. Here's our reality. Our world, listen to me, our world is both physical and spiritual. There are two sides to this coin. It's a physical and spiritual world. This is a foundational thinking for those of us who are in Christ. And so if you're new to Christianity and new to thinking and of what Christianity stands for, spirituality is a big deal. There's an understanding of a spiritual world that is entwined within our physical world. And so for so many of us, though, we live short-sighted. We keep our eyes solely focused on and aware of and dependent on the here and now. Like we only have eyes set on what's right in front of us. So when it comes to depending on God, listen, who is spirit, God who is truth, God who is unseen, we struggle, right? We begin to struggle because we're used to depending on what we can see and what is in front of us here and now, because it comes a point where we think it would just be easier if I took over. It's kind of difficult depending on a God that I don't see, and so I'm just going to take the reins for myself. And so we convince ourselves it would be easier to become my own power source. I'm good enough. I'm strong enough. Gosh darn it, people like me, right? Yeah, I mean, that becomes our mantra. Like, we can do this. We can make it happen. And so we think it's easier to become this power source rather than depending on him as our power source. And here's one of the ways I think this works out. You know, when I grew up, again, blessed family. I grew up, I had somebody tell me that I need to be praying about the relationships I was going to get in. And that's counter to our world. That doesn't make sense. But someone told me, you need to be praying about these significant relationships. If you're thinking about dating people, you need to be praying about who that person is and how you guys are going to meet and what, you know, your focus is going to be. So I did that. So I started praying about these relationships. And what's the problem? I prayed for 3 days and nothing happened. Right? Amen. Right? I mean, I've been praying fervently for 24 hours, and I haven't seen the Lord put somebody on my doorstep. So what happens? We tend to take back the reins. God's taken too long, and so I'm going to take back the reins on this. And if you're like me, you take it into your own hands. You stop depending on God to lead you to the right person, and instead, you start to force things. You force a relationship that you knew and everybody around you knew was never a good idea, but because you decided to become the source of that decision, you weren't able to see that it was a bad idea. Because you're living one-dimensionally. You're living only in the here and now, the physical. You see, we all live in this tension. We live in this tension between the physical and the spiritual. So here's the question. What is the best way to live in this tension? How do we live most effectively and most significantly in this tension? And here's the main point of the whole message. So we're about to get our note sheets out. So type A people, get your note pens ready. Here we go. All right. How do I want you to live? I want you to live trusting in the power source, the Holy Spirit. I want you to live trusting in the power source, who is the Holy Spirit, instead of trying to be the power source, trying to become the power source. Because so many of us, we're trying. Our lives are defined by trying to make it happen, trying to fix it, trying to make it work, and it's exhausting. Right? You've been there. You've lived in those moments where you try, and you leave exhausted. We're going to look at a passage today. It helps us to understand the value of trusting versus trying, all right? So keep that in your mind. Trusting versus trying. So go ahead, if you have a Bible, go ahead and turn to Romans 5. All right, Romans 5 is directly after Romans 4, so you should be able to find it pretty easy. If you don't have a Bible, here's the thing. We want to give you a Bible because we think being a people of the Word, it really does help and change things, okay? So if you don't have a Bible, don't leave without here. Without one. We'll give you one somehow, okay? But you can download the YouVersion app. Listen, as we study Scripture, heads up, I learn best with a pen in my hand. Engage it. Circle words. Underline key phrases. Write your questions in the margin. Engage the text, because then you begin to integrate the content a little bit more significantly, all right? So engage the text. Right now, we're going to study the Word. Be all in right now. Be in. Be focused. Be here, all right? So we're going to jump into Romans 5, and here's the deal. Romans is a letter written by Paul to the church or churches in the city Rome, all right? So that's what these are. These are not necessarily books. They're letters written by one man to a particular community of people. And so many of you have heard of Paul. He's done amazing stuff in the church, but Paul was a trier before he met Jesus. We're talking about trusting versus trying. Paul was a trier. He tried. He worked hard, and he was good at working hard. Listen, when we first begin to see who Paul is, we know his name is Saul, right? And he's a Pharisee, and Pharisees were just religious people, pastors back in the day. So they didn't like pastors back then or today. It's a common thing, I guess. But he was a self-proclaimed Pharisee of Pharisees, which meant he knew what he was doing. When it came to matters of understanding and implementing and upholding the law, primarily laws created by men, all right, and lording it over their communities. These guys were just brilliant. They knew how to uphold the law to the nth degree. They knew how to, they knew how to hold it all together. So he was a man who didn't trust God and his power, but rather he tried really, really hard to become his own power. Well, here's the problem. That came to a point in his life where that all changed because he realized how impossible that kind of life is. He realized how impossible it is to try and try and try to be good enough and work hard enough. And finally, he broke. He was faced with his reality, and it broke him. And so he stopped trying, and he became trying to become the power. And he rather began to trust in God that he would provide the power for his life. He trusted that God would show up in his life. And he writes these words in Romans 5. To help us understand how we can start doing that too. All right, you ready for this? Romans 5, let's read it together. Well, I'm gonna read it, you just look at it. Here we go. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, these words in the passages are your notes for the day, so you're welcome. Since you have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. That is a huge statement, and so we're going to walk through it. We're going to spend a little bit of time so that we're all on the same page. Everybody say justified. Justified. There you go. Man, you guys are on it. So here's what this means. God, when he originally designed us, he designed us with this picture of perfection and being in community with him unhindered. So he designed us to be in relationship with him with nothing coming between us, but then sin entered the picture and did what? Created a gap. It shattered that original picture that we were going to experience life with him. And so this original design of being in relationship with God, unhindered, was shattered and broken by sin. And so what happened? Jesus came. All right, many of you know this story, but if you don't, it's amazing. Jesus, who is God, left the comfort of heaven and came into the mess we created. And here's what happens. We show up with our sin, and sin is heavy. Sin always comes with a consequence. It always comes with debt. It always comes with something that you owe. It always will oppress because you will always find yourself owing something. So Jesus comes in and he pays the debt of sin and gives you his righteousness. Do you get that? He gives you his holiness. So now you have God who is perfect, who cannot be in relationship with unholy things. He just cannot. The definition of being perfect and holy means he cannot be in communion with that which is unholy. So Jesus comes, he pays for our sin, and he gives us his righteousness so that we can now have a relationship with God. How amazing is that? And so when it says you are justified, that means when God looks at you, he doesn't see your brokenness, doesn't see your sin. He sees the righteousness of Jesus Christ, who is in you, who is making you holy. So you have been made holy. You have been justified. How? By faith. Everybody say faith. Faith. There you go. Faith. Here's what I mean by this. Faith can be translated a number of different ways. It means, I mean, faith is a good definition for the word. To believe, to trust. All right? And here's the deal. Faith, belief is more than just cognitive. You know what I mean? It's more than just a matter of the mind and thinking and knowing facts. Significant faith, faith that counts. Heads up, there's a faith that doesn't count. Read James. Faith that counts is threefold. You can remember it this way. Head, heart, and hands. All right, head, heart, and hands. So in your head, you begin to trust the evidence that is available. Like you look at our world, and you ask the question, why, and where did this come from? Long enough, you eventually get to, who did this? Who did this? It doesn't make sense that it would just happen. Someone or something is the causer of all of these things. So you have to ask yourself, and you have to answer it. Who caused this? Okay, then Jesus shows up, and he says the things that he did, and he does the thing that he did. And it wasn't just recorded in the Bible. It was recorded in extra biblical literature that he was this man who was called a prophet, and he was doing miraculous things. And so you hear the things that he says, that he is God, he is Lord. So what do you do with that based on the evidence? And then they crucify him, and they can't find his body 3 days later. Hard evidence. What do you do with that? You see, our faith is not a blind faith. Faith is not meant to be blind based on something that your parents tell you or based on a feeling. Our faith is based and determined by an event that has happened. Trust the evidence. That's the head. And the head always leads to the heart. So not only do we begin to know about God, we begin to want to know more about God. You know what I mean? Where there's something in us that desires a relationship with Him. Faith always leads you in this way. You know about Him, but now you want to know Him more. You want a relationship with Him built on love. And so it kind of continues down that way. And then it leads inevitably to being an expression of the hands, all right? So head, heart, and it always works its way out. What's in the heart always works its way out. And so by knowing Him and having a relationship with Him, you will then submit your will to Him. You will serve Him in obedience. You will give His hands to the things that matter to Him. You'll give your hands to things for His kingdom, not your own. You see, whenever I'm trying to understand my relationship with God, it's always helpful for me to understand my relationship with my wife, because that's a relationship that is tangible, it's right in front of me. And so it's same thing, head, heart, and hands. You know, there was a point where I got to know about my wife, Lindsay. I knew her family, and I knew that she had siblings, and I knew objectively that she was the most gorgeous person in the world. So those are hard evidence, right? That you can be measured tangibly, empirically, right? That I know about her. But my head knowledge of her led to a desire to want to know her more. There was a point where I was not satisfied just knowing about her. I wanted to be in relationship with her. I wanted to experience a relationship with her built on love. I wanted to know her more. And the head affects the heart, which always affects the hands. And so I loved her with my head, my heart, and my hands, meaning that I would serve her. I know where some of you went. That I would serve. You know, that I would give up the things that I love, and I would use my hands to sacrifice for this relationship, because I'm willing to put myself aside. I don't do it perfectly, but the head always impacts the heart, which always affects the hands. That's what significant faith does. And heads up, all of us have faith in something. All of us are trusting something. All of us are banking on something. You're putting your trust in something that you hope is going to accomplish what you want. Some of us think that if I work really hard, it's going to equal security. Some of us think if I just have this relationship, it will equal identity, or it will equal value or worth. And so we try to find those relationships. We try to impress people. We try to work hard. We try to do all these things, and it keeps us missing out what is right in front of us. See, we are all prone to trust in something. The question is, are we trusting in a thing that counts? The thing that matters, all right? And so in this passage, again, this thing helps us understand that, one, you are justified by faith because of Jesus, all right? And that puts you in a really incredible position, being at peace with God. Everybody say peace. Peace. And listen, don't miss this, okay? Putting your trust in Jesus presents you justified before Him, means there is now nothing between you. No thing to cause His wrath against you, but you are now at peace with Him. You can have a conversation with Him, and He listens to you. He can speak to you, and you can hear from Him. You can experience freedom from not carrying any offense against you anymore because of His forgiveness. Listen, some of us in this room have no clue how light peace really is. Some of us are here today, and we think it's normal. We think it's normal carrying all the things that we are carrying right now. We think it's normal carrying anxiety and carrying insecurity and carrying the pain of our past and carrying the burdens of generations passed down. We think that's normal to carry those things, and we don't know how light and awesome peace really is for us. So when we translate peace, we think that it's just getting lost in Netflix series each night. That's peaceful, because you know what? I can get lost here. And we translate escaping from our burdens as peace, but it won't last. It's not strong enough. It's not powerful enough. You see, the peace of God is a consuming kind of peace. It's a peace that is rooted in eternity. Remember, we are spiritual beings. This world is both spiritual and physical. And so therefore, peace from God transcends your circumstances, transcends the things that you're dealing with day in and day out, because it's rooted in eternity. It's only found in the comfort of God. And we miss it because we've stopped trusting Him and we started believing that we can just handle it on our own. And so look where this passage goes, verse 2. Through Him, listen, through Him, you have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand. We rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Listen, by trusting Jesus, God opens the door to His grace. All of us experience God's grace. You can be far from God, you can hate God, you still experience His grace. He keeps you from experiencing things. He provides things. His rain still waters your lawn, okay? His grace covers all of us. But there's a difference between experiencing His grace on occasion and standing in His grace daily. Jesus opened the door and gave us access to stand in His grace daily. And when you do that, you rejoice in hope. It's amazing to me how starting from one place, just by trusting, okay, just by trusting in God, trusting in His power, you receive justification, you receive peace, you receive all these things, you receive joy, you get to stand in His grace. Just by simply having this posture that says, I'm trusting You, I'm going to stop trying. Door after door after door seems to open. And I've had seasons where I've tried to do it on my own, where I'm trying to pry doors open. I'm trying to make things happen. And say I do get one of those doors open and I run to the end of the hall and it's the dead end. Have you had those seasons of life too? It feels like quicksand, where the harder you try, the harder you fight, the harder you work, the harder you do these things, it seems like the more stuck you get, the more you get trapped, the more you have to carry, the more you have to carry, and it just gets harder and harder and harder. Because we're trying on our own while the power of God is available if we will only trust Him. Listen, by definition, grace cannot be enjoyed if you are trying to earn it. Grace is unmerited, unearned, undeserved favor and goodness of God. And so by definition, if you're trying to earn it, you can't actually receive it. You can't enjoy the depth of God's grace if you're working so hard to make it happen. The only way it can be fully embraced and enjoyed is by trusting in His power. So now let's jump down to verse 5 and let's go here. So the hope does not put us to shame. His hope does not put us to shame. It doesn't disappoint. It's not going to lead a dead end. That's what He's saying. Because God's love has been poured into your hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Listen to this right here, guys. Listen. The problem with trying to be your own power source is that your focus remains on what you are hoping to get. The problem with trying is your focus remains on what you are hoping to get. Trusting, on the other hand, is trusting the power of the Spirit means that your focus is what you have already been given. That's the huge difference. Trying means your focus is on what you are trying to get. You're grasping at things, but you're never taking hold. While trusting in the power of the Spirit focuses on the power that you have already been given. That is a huge difference. Paul is wanting everyone to know that trusting in God is a lot better than trying on your own. It is what you have already been given that enables you to accept and enjoy the fact that you are justified. Accept and enjoy the fact that you are at peace. Accept and embrace grace upon grace upon grace, because you're standing in His grace because of a door He opened for you. That's a different ballgame. So how does this play out? And we got a few minutes, and so we're going to rush through this last part here, but how does this play out? And here's what I want to say. When you live from the posture of trusting the power of the Spirit, it gives you two incredible things. You ready for this? Here's the first thing. It gives you courage. And let me read this. Acts 1:8 is a powerful passage. Listen to this. It gives us, trusting in the power of the Spirit gives us courage. Look at this. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be My witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And so when you have the power of the Holy Spirit, you have courage to do what He has called you to do. Every one of us in this room, if you are here, you are called to something. He has a calling and plan for you. And here's what's amazing. He's going to give you the power of the Spirit to accomplish what you've been called to do. But so many of us try to accomplish what we've been called to without the power to actually accomplish it. He designed it so that he would give you a call on your life and he would fill you with the ability to accomplish that thing. But what is the greatest calling, greatest mission for every one of us? Say Tuesday, this week, you accomplish all your stuff, right? Laundry's done for the next 3 weeks. I don't know how you do that, but you did. You've cooked all the meals. You know, you've gone to work. You've done all your work for 3 weeks in a row in 2 days. You have nothing to do. What is the one thing that you need to do? Here's what Scripture says. Share the good news of Jesus with those who don't know him yet. If there's one thing that's going to count for you, it is sharing the good news of Jesus with those who don't know him yet. That was the commission. That's what Jesus said. Hey, heads up. I'm going to leave here, and I'm going to leave you with one thing. Go and make disciples. That's what matters. That's what counts. And he's going to give you the courage to actually do it. You know, he's going to give you what you need to accomplish that. And here's how this works. All right, Jesus looks at his church and he sees us, the church, dispersed throughout the city every week. So now there are Spirit-filled Christians entering almost every corner of the community of this city. And Jesus put you there in that place for that reason, because soon your buddy or your friend is going to come to you and share how life is hurting right now, share how their marriage is falling to pieces, or share how this thing has just happened in their life. And not only are they shaken, but they feel lost and alone. And it's amazing how when life hurts, people run and they seek out Christians. They want to know why you're different. They want to know where your courage comes from. They want to know why, when these things happen to you, you're not shaken like I am. Because we are people who trust in the power of the Spirit, which gives us the ability to transcend the things that are happening here and now. It gives us the ability to transcend the circumstances that are coming. Your courage comes from him. And when that person shows up at your office or shows up at your house or gives you a call, listen, you have an opportunity. You can try and fix them. You can try to avoid their mess, right? Or you can trust in the power of the Spirit to help you get where you need to go. Listen, you may not even have the right answers, and you still need to trust. Because heads up, you don't change people's lives. God does. Heads up, you don't have the power to fix their situation. The Spirit does. All the Spirit needs you to do is show up trusting him with the courage that he provides to do the thing he has called you to do. So one, he provides courage. And listen, I love that we've been praying for one. I love that we've been praying for one. But now it's time to invite your one to something. Now it's time to share your story with your one. Now it's time to do something. And maybe you get an opportunity to stand in this baptism with your one because you prayed and you stepped out in the power of the Spirit, trusting he's going to show up with the courage required to do the one thing that matters most, which is help people know him and be known by him. That's what matters. And the Spirit's the one who gives you the courage to do that. Here's the next thing that happens. He gives you confidence. Romans 5, these are the verses we skipped. Here, look at this. 3 and 4. Not only that, but we rejoice in our suffering. That sounds crazy for those who missed it. We rejoice in our suffering. There are two kinds of people that say that. Crazy people and people who trust in the power of the Spirit, because they've been there before. And they know that suffering now equals hope later. Look at this. Suffering produces endurance. Endurance produces character. Character produces hope. Paul understood these things because he lived out of the power of the Spirit. He understood that it doesn't matter what's coming. It doesn't matter what life's going to throw at you. It doesn't matter the things that you're going to go through, because you might find yourself in the deepest, darkest pit of your life, and with the power of the Spirit, it's going to end up on a mountaintop. That's what he knows. He knows that your suffering can lead you to hope. Your suffering can point you to hope. But here's what he knows. Without him, it's not possible. Trusting in the power of the Spirit gives you courage to face what you need to. Gives you confidence in the midst of a storm to pursue him and hold on to hope. And here's what happens. Here's how it ends. For those who trust God, Paul says, suffering produces endurance. Endurance produces character. Character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint. It does not put to shame. Here's what happens. Because God's love has been poured into your hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Listen to me, guys. I got to wrap it up. I'm sorry. Imagine this, though. Imagine if we became a people that we're courageous, unhindered, our courage unhindered because of the power of the Spirit? What if our confidence was unhindered because we trusted in the power of the Spirit? What if our entire church became Spirit-filled, power-driven, not the power of our world, but the power of the Spirit driven into our community? Think of how that would change every business that we are a part of, every family that you are a part of, everything that you are a part of could be changed if you would do one thing: stop trying and start trusting the power of the Spirit that is at work within you. Because when that happens, you fully embrace the fact that you've been justified. You fully embrace the fact that you have been given peace, eternal peace, not some peace that flees from you. You understand that you've been given the doorway into His grace, and you get to experience a hope that will not disappoint. It's not going to go away, and it will carry you through this life. Nothing's going to change that. That's what happens when you trust and stop trying. Let's pray. Here we go. Father, thank you for your grace. Thank you for your love for us. Help us to honor you. Help us to depend on you, pursue you, go after the things that you're about. And we know that there's nothing in us on our own that can accomplish those things. Nothing in us is powerful enough to push back the darkness, but you can. Nothing in us is as powerful enough to fight addiction that plagues our culture, but you can. If we trust you, if we lean into you and depend on you, it'll change everything. But give us the courage to do that, Father. We pray in your name. Amen. And so here's what we get to do, guys. And we do this every week. We come, we hear the word, and we get to respond. And let me just do this real fast. Quick confessional on my part. Literally 2 hours ago, I was preparing for this message in the back here, and I was just a little stressed out, because certain things weren't working right. Have you had those mornings, you know, where everything's chaos right before you get to church, and then when you get here, you're like, oh, hey. You know, that was one of those mornings. I was just, like, stressed out. And I was sitting back there praying, and I was saying, God, I'm trying really hard here. God, I'm trying to make this happen for you. God, I'm trying to make this work. I'm trying to see this happen. I want this to be great. I want it to work out. And God's like, Harrison, stop trying. Right? I'm like, hey, maybe someone should write a sermon about this. Stop trying. Trust me. Trust me. I'm going to give you what you need. And that's true for all of us. Okay? I know it's hard. I know it's hard to stop trying and start trusting Him, because we can see what's in front of us. And it's easier to try, even though we know it's not going to work out. But trusting opens doors that we weren't aware of. And so here's how you can respond. You ready for this? If you've never put your trust in Jesus, you've been walking around with the weight of consequences of our sin, the weight of things of this world. You've been carrying stuff that you think you hear about people being free from, but you've been holding on to it. You can be free from it. You can experience joy and forgiveness. You can be liberated from your past. You don't have to carry that junk with you every day. You can leave it, and you can start trusting the power of the Spirit to get you where you need to go next. So if you've never given your heart to Him, you've never surrendered, you've never put your trust, your head, your heart, and your hands all towards His kingdom, if you haven't done that, then come do it now and be baptized. Man, experience new life. Experience freedom. So if you've never done that, come and do that. Maybe you're someone here who's been trying, and you're like, man, I need someone. I need to pray with somebody. I need someone to just tell me, stop trying. Start trusting. If you're here and you need to do that, while we sing this song, I want you to come up right here, all right? So let's stand. Let's sing this song together. And if you need to make a decision, come find me right here.